Welcome back to Mind Goals Podcast, hosted by yours truly, Siobhan Higgins, professional soccer player and sports psychology consultant. Last week, you got two episodes, one in honor of Valentine's Day and how not to fall out of love with your sport. And then secondly, you got to meet one of my former teammates from Hungary, Claire Stackle. Today, we have another teammate joining me, and this will conclude the Hungarian saga. And so today, joining us from California, we have Miss Sabrina Williamson, also known as Sabs, or if you're our coach, Williamson.
Them's fighting words, Chevs. So be careful. Thanks for having me. I'm so glad you guys are doing this series, and I'm excited to share my experience.
Yeah, thank you for being willing to talk about it. I know that we all have different perspectives and different experiences, and so I'm sure everyone would be really interested to hear about your point of view.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So I started off Claire's episode kind of asking how she even got to Hungary. And so if you could maybe tell the audience a little bit about where you played college soccer and then what was the deciding factor for you jumping across the pond?
Yeah, I think, you know, going overseas was always the intention. While I was playing at Cal State Stanislaus, it's a Division II school in the Central Valley in California. I loved playing on that team. It was very high level. We'd tie and sometimes beat some D1 teams. So, you know, I like to say, like, you know, we're up there. We could have been D1, but it was just a fun school. But it was really in my sophomore year of high school, or not, excuse me, of college, where I was like, okay, I need to start preparing. Like, I'm ready to go professional. And I knew I didn't want to play in the NWSL. I felt like it was too impacted. And I wanted an experience abroad. I wanted to go overseas. Unfortunately, I did suffer an ACL injury, the second to last league game of my senior year.
Oh my gosh. I did not know that.
It was heartbreaking. And it was a contact injury too. So I didn't expect I didn't expect it to happen. I'd gone in and I got slide tackled after saving a shot, and she fractured my femur.
Oh my God.
Like, yeah, it was not good. And you know, tore the ACL. I had some meniscus damage. And it was just, my heart broke. Because I was even considering leaving college early to go overseas.
Oh my God.
Online, yeah.
Did you say it was the second to last game of the season?
I was so close. I was so, and that's what made it so bitter. Like, but then, you know, I finished out, I got my degree in biology and chemistry and my minor in chemistry. And then, you know, I kept pushing. I played semi-pro at Cal Storm, and, I followed the statistic. I fell for it, right? Like I did end up having a non-contact ACL injury. So both of my knees were just done.
Whoa. Wait, so okay. So you tore your ACL, rehabbed until you were able to play again, and then you tore your other ACL? And was it like immediately, like that first game back, or a couple games?
First season.
Oh,
it was a few
gosh.
Games in. Honestly, it was a bad surface. My shoes were too big. It was a perfect storm. I didn't stretch right. Like everything together was against me. And I was like, you know what? And as soon as it slid, I knew. And I remember like punching like a dent in my in the side of like my dad's car.
Car? No, not the car.
I hurt my hand. I hurt my hand badly. Like I remember being so angry. I was like, I did everything right. Just, so mad. But so at that point I was like, I don't know what I'm going to do. Like, do I keep going? Do I keep pushing? And that's when I ended up I applied to Berkeley to get my master's of public health.
Okay.
MD. And I was like, you know what? If I'm not going to be a professional right now, I'm going to be a professional in another way.
Hell yeah.
So yeah, I was like, I'm not going down like that.
Exactly.
I kept going through the degree, and that's when I finally got an agent. I think we had the same one, did we?
I actually did not. You and Claire had the same agent.
Okay. Well, yeah, that's right. And he ended up getting me an opportunity with Hungary, and I was surprised. I was like, Hungary? What's like in Hungary? I don't know. I don't know.
Right?
It's slim pickings for me. My college coach didn't have film for me, unfortunately. So I had to get something. I needed to get film. And we all know how important that was at the end of that.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Holding it hostage from us. But yeah, that's how I ended up at Hungary. And yeah.
Wow. Okay. So
long bad story.
I empathize with you because I'm also joined the club 2-time ACL tear. I tore mine when I was 18. And then 10 years later, so last year, I tore my other one. But I do, yeah, I understand the grind. But for you to go back to back, that's difficult, but that shows your resiliency. I mean, and for you to go, I just love that other athletes can hear this story. And because some people think that it's done, right? That you played or it's you can't go to college anymore if you do it in high school. Or if you do it in college, you can't play anymore because you can't make it pro. But you can. I mean, we have real proof of it. And so good for you. And then you killed the season. If I'm being honest, I'm biased, but you did really well. Yeah.
So I feel like that at the time.
I know it didn't feel like that. Trust me.
it really didn't. But no, just to tap back on that for any women's soccer player who's listening, like don't be afraid of grieving your career because you never know if there is a second chance after that. And I had to do that so many times. I had just crying in my bed, like it's over, it's done. But then, you know, you have to get it out. You have to get the worst case scenario out, right? And then the next step feels more believable for you. And if I were to step away, I think that I would have been okay. You know, I would have found something else. But I'm glad I went through it. Yeah.
Yeah, and I appreciate that you mentioned that you got your master's because you said, you know, if I'm not going to be pro in this, I'm going to be professional in this. That's awesome because something as like a sports psychology consultant, we advise athletes to do is don't identify yourself as just an athlete because you never know when you're going to get injured or you never know when you're not going to be able to play or I don't know, COVID, right? You can't play at the moment. So you just have to remember the other things that make you who you are. So if you are a professional, I don't know, if you're trying to get your doctorate, if you are also, you have another hobby or if you're a mom or something, you know, just tap into those other things that make you you other than just your sport, because there is going to come that day eventually where it's still a part of you, but you're not playing anymore.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I was seeing a therapist at that time and they said the same thing to me. So please keep spreading that message. It's so important to be someone beyond your sport, even though we're told otherwise, like, oh, put everything into practice, everything into the game. And it's misleading as far as like what our identity actually is.
Exactly. Yeah. It's the identity thing. Because then when it's gone, people have an identity crisis. Like, I don't know what I'm going to do anymore. And it's okay to, you know, put your all 100% into all of those different, you know, aspects, but definitely tap into something else as well. Or just know that you are more than your sport. But I do want to dive into a little bit more about your experience. So here we go. So we're in Hungary and then in my first episode, I mentioned, okay, I know you're looking up. You're like, what could she possibly say? And I was talking about my rooming situation in, And so when I first arrived, guys, for the audience to hear, the room that I declined or left ended up being Sabs's room. Yeah. And so I took the shoebox over living in a studio situation. Could you tell the audience a little bit about how that was for you? Like, what were your first thoughts when you got there? Were you told where you were going to live? Were you told what it was going to be set up like? Yeah. Or were you just shocked?
My agent told me nothing. He's like, no, they'll take care of you. Like he kept it very like general and like high level. He didn't give me any details, even if I had pressed. And I remember getting there and then being confused on where I was going to stay. And yeah, when I got, cause I first got to the locker room, you know, I watched the practice and everything. And then, I did end up going home with, our Canadian teammate.
Mm-hmm.
And that's who I ended up, you know, rooming with. It's hard to say because like you said in the first episode, it was a one bedroom for two people.
Yeah.
And the And it was a couch. I was sleeping basically on a couch that doubled as like a futon kind of thing. Which
my back.
In hindsight, you know, the switch actually was good. It was good. Because I was in school at the time, I did have that open space.
Okay.
So I had like a little desk area for myself. Whenever I had to hop on Zoom to like do group projects or something like that. So it wasn't too bad, but man, I had no privacy. and like we had these heavy smokers downstairs. And so I had to try to keep it. Yeah. It was Europe. Everyone smokes, right?
Yeah.
So I had to try to like keep everything locked up and closed. Everything, every time we cooked, like my sheets smelled like it.
Damn.
Like I just smelled like it. And I was like, this is just what it is. But
oh man.
Yeah. In hindsight, I think I liked having at least the open space.
Mm-hmm.
And my roommate, like, she had stayed in her room most of the time anyway, because she also had an ACL injury. So
I know, so yeah. Sad. But okay. Mm-hmm. So and also she's playing again in another country and doing really well. So happy for her.
Killing it! I'm so proud of her.
Oh, she was a tank too. Really good soccer player.
Shout
out to our Canadian. but yeah, okay. Now, at least now you know that you'd be comfortable living in a studio apartment, right?
No, I have very high standards now. I'm not doing that again. I just need to know that I could do it, and then I'm like, okay, I've been humbled. I'm good. Can I move on now?
Good. Okay, so that was your initial thought with the living environment. How about training environment? Like, because for me, I mentioned first day, and I'm also kind of forgetting whether you were there before I was. No, you were there after, obviously, because there's room. Okay. So what were your initial thoughts on training, how it was run, and then maybe some of the teammates, maybe some of the rules, or just first thought you got thrown in the mix and you were like, okay.
Yeah. You know, when I first got there, it was a practice. Like, it was nighttime. I was like, man, it's cold up in here. Like, I'm from California. I was like, this is not what I'm used to. It's cold.
Was it snowing at the time?
Canadians laughing at me. but I, you know, again, like, this is my first professional experience. I don't know, maybe I didn't say that, but yeah, it's my first professional experience. My confidence was not very high. You know, considering my injuries, I was just very, you know, like, oh, can I do this? You know, I still had some of those doubts in my head. So I was watching practice. I was actually pretty intimidated because I felt like it was going so fast paced. And I just, you know, I was trying not to psych myself out. And but then when folks came back into the locker room, they seemed really friendly at first, and I say that, I have to say it like that, it did seem friendly at first. The coach seemed kind of normal at the time again, and I was really excited. I came in like with a very positive attitude, my impressions grew a lot as you know, training started to continue. And I do have a lot to say about that part. Cause, you know, like there was a moment where I walked off the, like he, well, I didn't walk off the boat. I got kicked off. He was like, you need to go. You need to just like step off the field. And I was like, well,
I think I remember that. Would you mind talking about it? We don't have to, but
yeah, I don't mind. There was,
I'll go after.
There was one practice. First of all, I was tied between trying to be open-minded and learn a new style of soccer, right?
Yeah.
And you know, he told us, yeah, we do a lot of things after Atletico Madrid. And I was like, okay. I went back and, yeah.
No, he did not.
I went back and started like really watching like Trippier at the time. He was outside back. I was like really trying to study. And I was like, we're not doing anything like this.
He compared his training sessions to Atletico Madrid.
Yeah.
Shut up. Oh god.
He told me that. He pulled me aside because I was trying to like establish a professional relationship with this man. And you know, because I could tell he was getting a little frustrated with me. I was like, it's really because I don't understand what you're saying. And I should have admitted that. I should have just admitted the fact that I don't understand a word you're saying. And I just didn't want to offend him. And I'm like, there's people pleasing Sabrina.
Oh, okay.
Oh, people pleasing Sabs. But yeah, so we're doing this drill. Like, you know, we go up one side and back the other side. And you know that thing when coaches like mess up, but you can't really say anything. And you're like, no, you did it wrong. That happened like several times in that practice. And I was like, what do you want me to do here? And then he got mad. He started screaming. And I think by this point, I'd just been He had just made so many jabs by that point. I was like, I just started to break down a little bit. I was like, and I just turned my head to the side for a moment, and he saw just a glimpse of emotion, and he was like, get off the field. And I was like, fine.
I have a question. Was this like a walkthrough to where we were doing like a starting lineup thing? Because I think I remember once coming on for you in a situation similar to that. Okay.
He came on for me. That was it.
Okay. And he was so rude, by the way. I don't want to, I don't know, because I know it's not a great memory to bring up, but I remember him like name calling. It was so fucking called out. Like he straight up was like, are you an idiot? And I was like, oh my God, is this serious? Like, this is so, he's just like berating you and belittling you in front of everyone, humiliating you, and then throwing me in the mix and saying, you try. And I was like, I'm not even a left back, but okay. So what do you want me to do?
Yeah. That was rough. I'm a person who, like, I'm not used, I'm like, I'm sorry. I'm not, being humiliated is not something that is new to me. I have been bullied before, especially on teams. And so that wasn't new to me, but I think it was the fact that at the time I wasn't confiding in somebody, and I wasn't, I think it was just too much.
It was too much. Yeah. He wouldn't leave you alone. It was straight up bullying.
Yeah. Yeah. And, there was that point where I was like, this is not professional. This is not being done correctly. Like, and also like, even if he was, it would be different if he was teaching us something new on the field, teaching us something that was helpful and helping me grow as a player. I was like, dude, like, my college team would wreck y'all.
Exactly. I'm like, let's kind of do a little pregame match. Yeah, seriously, we would destroy that team.
Would wreck them. I was like, this
especially
is
especially this
like
lame
I'm
ass formation
back.
You have us in.
Gonna be grateful, you know, the injuries. You know, the resilience, like I tried to like, you know, get back into that frame of mind. Like, you should be really grateful and happy to be here. But at the same time, I'm like, when is my limit going to happen? I think near the end, it did happen. You know, I was just talking right at him a few times. And I was like, I don't care. That's not what's happening. I'm not an idiot. Like, it's you, honey. Like, you're the problem.
Exactly. Yeah. I remember after that training feeling like, I remember reaching out to you and trying to let you know, like, hey, it was not you, like, it's him and he's an asshole. And this is not normal, because I know that for Katie and a couple other people, like Claire, so Katie, yourself and Claire, it was your first time playing abroad, but it was my like second or third. And so I had prior experience and I was like, this is not normal. This is not how it's supposed to be. And I want everybody to know that, but not many people did. And so that's why I felt like I had to take place of being the defiant or the one that has stood up to him. And I kind of paid for that with no game time. But I mean, you did what had to be done.
You really, you know, Siobhan, you really walked so that we could run. Like, I mean it. I mean it. And it was really after that practice that I was like, and I did feel better. It was you and it was Katie. You guys pulled me aside outside of the locker room. And I was like, wow, like I need people. I was like, I need to confide in my American teammates who are here, who understand like what just happened. Because otherwise, I was gaslighting myself. I'm like, am I an idiot?
Right.
Am I stupid? Like, debatably, and I hate to brag about this, but I was probably the most educated person in that room on paper. And I was like, there's no like.
Yeah, you're like, no, I'm not stupid. No way.
No, like there's.
You're like me. This is the first time.
I don't want people to know. I want them to treat me. I want to see how they treat me without knowing anything about me. I was like, I need you to treat me how like a human being first. Like, you don't need to know where about my background or anything like that. But he didn't care. So, but no, it was after that that I was like, no, I need to spend time with my teammates. It's not just about soccer. Like, there's an opportunity for growth here. So yeah, that was rough.
It was rough. Yeah, the culture was horrible. It was very toxic, and he cultivated that. And I think. I would like to say we shook it up a little bit, but there's no way that it's better. I don't know, now that we've gone.
Well, I don't know. Cause I think, you know, and I think you've touched on this in conversations that we've had, you know, years ago. I'm remembering it, like at least the youngers that were there were able to see it. You know, like there was a 16-year-old, oh my gosh, she was 10 years younger than me. It was so weird. And she was watching. And she was watching all of that. I think one of the goalkeepers was like 15 or something like that. I don't know, but they're watching. It makes an impact somehow. So, we'll see.
Oh, I'm thinking, like, do we reach out to them, see how they're doing? Like, seriously, like, just checking them.
Kind of want to do a little, yeah, a little life check.
And I do remember another time, actually. Do you remember when I think it was the day that I got assigned ball duty, but that one game where we didn't do well. No, there was another game we didn't do well, and I think we lost because someone on the other team shot took a shot from like 45 yards out and it went over our goalkeeper.
Oh yeah. Oh, he was so mad at her, and he blamed her for that entire game.
Entire game.
Like trash. Like there's no. Like I think I caused a PK that game because it bounced up and it hit my hand. I was like,
Oh
I did this time.
no.
I was like, should I be the one speaking up? I don't know. Like.
He was yeah, that was actually really bad. I remember he was blaming her for that loss. It was like 2-1. Also, why are we taking that shot from halfway? And I remember I went to go talk, the goalie was crying and visibly crying, which probably took a lot to do. And I remember going out to him after the game on the field because at this point I was like, whatever. I was like, hey, I don't really think that what you did in there was right. And he was like, what do you mean? And I straight up was like, it was kind of messed up. You don't have to yell at her, you know? And he goes, but she caused the goal. She let it in. And I was like, maybe she let it in or didn't save it. But why was she taking that shot? What happened beforehand in order for the ball to get there? Right. And also, it was 2-1, which means another goal went in. You know, also, what about the forwards? What about the people that aren't producing goals? You know, what about those things? Oh, I was so, he obviously didn't really care, but
I think it's still important to say it, and I will say like stand like the advocacy's like it's still you standing up for yourself and what you believe in, even if it's happening to somebody else. And that teammate camaraderie is just it's invaluable, like it's absolutely needed too. But even though like it did fall on deaf ears, like very, very deaf ears for him. Even you like saying that you did that, I was like, you know what? Like maybe next time I can say something. Maybe next time at the very least I can support my teammate better. Like it was encouraging, Siobhan. It really was. Like it was important that there were other Americans there who had years of professional experience. So I could see what's done, what needs to be done, like what's supposed to be done and what's not normal. But that was like routine. Like he just found somebody every time, every game. And I was like, this is not okay. None of this is, there's no way this is normal. But then again, like because this was the first experience, it was a battle between trying to figure out like, is this just the culture? Is this something I need to like humble myself to? Or is this something that's actually wrong, you know?
Yeah. And it was difficult to decipher what was going on because, you know, I think for me, it happened around month 1.5. I was like, okay, this is not absolutely, I'm going to say something now. But for other people, it took, you know, 2 months or 3 months. And so it was like a slow, not a slow death, but like a slow realization for other people. But for me, I realized it quicker and it was just a matter of saying something. And then once you personally realize it and then you learn how to deal with it, you know, because you stuck it out the whole season. Sorry, I didn't mention that in the beginning, but Sab's one of the ones stuck it out. So badge of honor for that. But can you tell people kind of about the ways that you coped or things that you did or who you spoke to? Like truly, how did you make it through the season? You know?
Yeah, that's a great question. Definitely regular calls to my support system at home. I would highly recommend that before any player ventures out overseas, establish that support system. Find a therapist, a sports psychologist now, because you never know what's going to happen over there. Excuse me, I've had two professional experiences. And I'm glad I did that. Like after that first experience, which was probably the worst one that most people could have, the second one was a lot better because I made sure I secured a support system. But and you know, I was connected to a religious organization there, a Christian organization. So I was kind of had that spiritual support as well. But the support that I didn't realize I needed, I really took for granted, like I mentioned before, was the team support. Like I said, I used to be bullied on teams, so my social anxiety is just off the roof when it comes to interacting with my teammates and making sure that like I'm liked or like anything like that. And like, no, it's not about that. Sometimes we just need to vent. We need to make sure that what's happening on the field is actually what's happening, because they be gaslighting you out there, and we need to make sure what's real. But yeah, a really funny, an unexpected coping mechanism that I had was actually TikTok.
Oh,
It was because of y'all. You kept doing the TikToks, and I was like, I don't know. I don't know if this is for me. But I was like, let me just go ahead and do this.
too. Wait, didn't
And
you have a viral one?
huh?
Didn't you get like a viral TikTok at one point?
I did, and I'll touch on that a little bit. I know one of the topics we're going to go over is the culture shock, right?
You can delve into it.
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. So one of my biggest issues, not issues, like I know what I look like here in this country, right? It's Black History Month. I'm gonna get into it. I was the only Black person on the team, and there was only one other Black person on the men's side, right? And like we were able to connect, but I didn't realize how much of a culture shock it was going to be the only person who looked like me in an area. And again, we're on the more remote part of Hungary. And everywhere I went, I was stared at, but it was a very uncanny stare, right? And it wasn't just like one or two. It'd be like everyone on the tram. Everyone. And it'd make me very uncomfortable, and it'd be every single day. And where I come from, when a whole bunch of people who don't look like you are staring at you with that intensity, that means danger. That means threat. That means like, so instinctively, like I'm on edge already going to training. And it wasn't until months into it that I decided I'm gonna have some fun with this. Let me just have some fun with this. Let me stop tying back my hair. Let me stop trying to hide my features to blend in. Let me just be myself. And I'd have staring contests with people. I practice waving at them, right? Yeah, I remember, like we got stared at anyway because we're Americans.
Yeah,
And
but
we
you have make
dress
a
up.
good point.
But yeah.
Your features are different. Yeah, and especially I know people. Didn't coach try to touch your hair once?
Yes. Oh my gosh, that fool tried to touch me. He tried to touch my hair, and I was like, "What? No! I think you said like, oh, you can look, but don't touch." And I was like, "No, hardly even look. Don't come my way. The nasty hands. Get them. No, get them away from me." But no, I remember like there's a man in a horse and buggy
I
on
think
this.
I have a video of this, of the man, horse, and buggy.
There's a man on a horse and buggy because East Hungary. And we had a stare off, and I was like, I'm not gonna break this. And so I kept staring. Like he turned his neck all the way around. Like we kept it going. And eventually I was like, hey. And I waved at him, and he waved back. And it was so sweet. He was like, hey, come sit next to me.
No, he didn't. Did he?
And I was like, okay, it's not so bad. That's creepy. I'm not gonna go with you. That's a trap. But that was still kind of cute. It made me feel it just, instead of the threat, it felt like, okay, they're just curious. It's fine. I'm not in danger. It's okay, right? So that was probably the biggest culture shock, is realizing their culture shock, right? They've never seen anyone. I've seen plenty of people who look like them, but we're in the United States. They've never seen anybody who looks like me, and I had to get used to that, because that didn't go away when I went to other countries. So.
Right. And I was going to say it because you went to Turkey next, correct?
I went to Kazakhstan, but we did play a lot in Turkey. Like it was a Champions League team, so we did have trainings in Turkey a lot. And I actually like Turkey sometimes more because there were more people there that looked like me.
Oh, nice. I have a couple teammates that play in Turkey. Yeah, or ex-teammates that play in Turkey. And I think they really like their experiences and they've revisited them.
Yeah, I would go back to Turkey. I loved it there. Yeah, the food, the hummus. Ooh.
The hummus?
Yeah, the hummus.
Oh. Okay, and then question, just because you touched on food for a second. So I don't really remember a traditional Hungarian dish. I don't know if that's because we were fed food from the cafeteria, you know, or because whenever I was ordering like sushi or like a Korean bowl, or I wasn't getting like chips and, you know, chicken nuggets or anything sometimes. But, you know, could you remember a Hungarian dish, or what type of food did you like there? What were you eating?
I mean, they would make that like little chicken, like cutlet thing where they deep fry it and like, okay, it's fried chicken. And they put mustard on it and like, okay, this is, it's doing it. Like it's protein. We're used to, you know, we've had fried chicken in the States, but no, I don't remember anything traditionally Hungarian. Just a lot of bolognese and.
I like bolognese. You're right. Yeah. You could get sick of it, but I'm a big pasta girl.
Mysterious sauces. Over rice. A lot of soup. I will say the soup was bomb.
Yeah. Yes.
The soup.
I liked soup. Yeah. I liked the soup days. I think they were like creamy soups as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Something that was kind of like Irish, but you know, I know that's more of like a Russian thing, but yeah, it wasn't too bad.
Is there anything that you, okay. Yeah. Is there anything that you miss about Hungary? Really, really dig in there and think. It took me a long time to think, but.
Yeah. You know, I miss the nature. Like when springtime came around, that was really fun. When I finally like, you know, let loose and hung out like with the team and we, you know, we went to that lake that one time. I was like, this is so much fun. The little canoe. It was beautiful.
It was beautiful.
I'm there in the dead winter, and I was like, "This is." But as soon as it started to warm up, I was like, "I could imagine staying here a little bit longer, not for the team, but for the nature."
Yeah. No, I agree, because I mentioned that the flowers are beautiful, the plants are beautiful, and truly the April showers bring May flowers. And for me, that was so metaphorical, because it was April crying all the time brings May happiness. You know.
There was a time when we were crying like quite a bit. And at least we weren't alone.
Never in public. Never.
Never.
Oh, you know what you just reminded me of for some reason? When we were paired as roommates for one away trip, and remember we had to move rooms because.
Oh, no. I was not going to let us stay in that room. Absolutely not. So yeah, we ended up going in that room, which already looked like a cabin in the woods kind of situation. I was like, I don't feel safe here, but we're all together and I'm pretty fast, so I'll get out of it. But we get into that room, and I've had a really, you know, bad experience with bed bugs once before. That's all it takes. And I was like, Siobhan, let me check the room. And, well, you're here. I was like, let me check the room real quick. Because I did see, I think there was, like, either a dead one or something on the wall. It just didn't look right to me. I was like, let me just double check. You know, I'm checking the mattress. And sure enough, like, I saw another dead one. I was like.
Disgusting.
That's all I need to know. Those are the worst, the absolute worst. But yeah, and then I went downstairs and I said, we need another room. You guys have bed bugs. I remember taking pictures. We like,
oh
yeah, we had to, like I like scooped it up. I think you were like gagging by that point, but like I scooped it up. I was like, I need evidence because they're not going to believe me. Took a picture, tossed it in the toilet, but that was disgusting.
I do remember getting an upgrade.
Oh, solid. Disgusting.
Yeah, bad. But it was okay. Now that I think about it, because I'm trying to paint the picture for the audience, is that sometimes we would go on away trips and it wasn't like a regular hotel. There were huts, if you will, or little cabins. And that was common. But that's so foreign for us or for me. You know, I don't think I've ever been in a situation like that. But it would have been nice if it was like a retreat vibe, but it wasn't. It was like lock your doors and stay inside of this room. And
speaking of that, I mean, we kind of wanted to lock our doors and stay in our rooms because of the night checks that our coach would do.
Yeah.
It's on that in the podcast, but that was not okay.
I haven't spoken about them.
Yeah. So for the audience, our coach would do little night checks for us, right? So he would come through at around like maybe 10 o'clock at night. Knock on our door, and sometimes, you know, he'd hang around. He'd lean against the wall. He didn't care if we were in the shower. He didn't care if we just got out. He would just hang out however long that he wanted to. And I remember him looking at one of our teammates like very inappropriately, like at her shirt. You remember this? Oh. It was when she came down, later she came downstairs and she,
When they, is this when he made a comment?
Yes, he had made that comment. Yeah.
He made, okay, so he made a comment at breakfast as well. So I know what you're talking about. So for more context, the coach would come around and do night checks. This is kind of common in teams, you know, in college or wherever else. They'll come and just make sure you're in the room. Some coaches will even put like a piece of tape around the door or at the edge of the door. So if you were to leave, it's moved. But we're professionals and we're adults. So that didn't happen. Instead, unethical things happen, like lingering for too long. It's hi, okay, you two are in here. Good, goodbye, and get out. Also, you know kind of your distance and your space. But this particular situation was in the morning when you'd come down for team breakfast, and our coach said to one of our teammates, you know, he actually called her over and he said, oh, you know, are you cold? And, you know, why else? Because obviously we are humans and bodies react to temperature. And so she felt so humiliating, kind of like crossed her arms. And he's like, ha, ha, ha. I'm like, you're disgusting. There's no, and it was so many moments of no way that just happened. Are you being for fucking real? And I remember he brought it up again. And so I was like, tell my friend, you know, do you want like my hoodie? Do you want to just put your hair down maybe? Because we're already downstairs at breakfast. You're too afraid to go back up to your room and be missing. So we're sitting there at breakfast and he said it again. Like he said it to make sure that everybody else could hear, you know, oh, somebody's cold. Make sure you wear like a sweater or something because blank so-and-so is cold. And I remember being ready to like risk it all. I was like, this is the day my fist makes contact with his face because are we so serious? Like I mentioned, I was like, hey, no, that's not okay. Like, it's making my adrenaline go up right now.
And it's really funny that you mentioned that because in that moment, you're kind of like, what do I do? And I would tell people about these experiences as it was happening. And they're like, you should tell someone.
Dude. Yeah.
Who am I going to tell? Like,
exactly.
His friends are the higher ups, like the directors, like everyone at the higher ranking. They're all a part of it.
Exactly. And that's the problem. It was a systematic problem because, oh, yeah, I'm going to go tell my coach to his boss who is also saying the same things. You know, no, we can't. So the only thing you could do was one, stand up to it. Or sorry, there's three. One, stand up to it and kind of get in trouble. Two, leave. Or three, just say nothing and let him continue.
And all three of those things happened. I watched all of them. It's yep. Yeah. Oh, by the way, I need to mention, if I wanted to leave, I couldn't.
Okay, why? Wait, what? What's that?
So after Claire left, I think he got wise, and he didn't. He never gave me my visa. I need to say this. I need to say this. Like for I almost didn't get out of there. It was a whole thing, and I never told you because I was just trying to go home and be with my family. I truly believe that after Claire left, he got wise, and he filled out my paperwork late and like I had to do like a bunch of appointments with him and drive with him over to the to like whatever office to get that done. He held on to it the entire time.
Oh my gosh.
So when I did finally leave and I was in the airport, I thought everything was fine. I think the rule at the time is like you couldn't stay over a certain number of days.
Yeah. I think 3 months.
Right? But I was like, oh, well, my contract should be enough. I never got a visa. I never got it physically in hand. They kept it. I even asked him, I was like, can I have it? He was like, no, we'll hold on to it. And I was like, that's not normal. It's not normal. And it's not normal. Keep your visa, ask for your visa. Make sure you have it in your passport, on your person at all times. So when I did try to leave, like I got in trouble. They put me aside. They're like, you're here illegally.
What?
It's my flight.
You missed your flight?
Yeah, I had to call the office.
Oh my God.
Teammates helped me. And I was on Viber and I'm crying. I'm like, they won't let me leave. I'm gonna miss my flight. I just want to go home. Like I was like, this person is ruining everything. Like, I just want to leave. And I think he did that on purpose. Because I couldn't leave even if I wanted to.
I'm so sorry. I did not know that happened. I mean, and after all, like the desperation to leave that country and just go home and for that to happen is just, oh my gosh.
Yeah. So get your visa, make sure it's with you. It's Yeah. So I was kind of like, and that creeped me out just like deeply. I was like, it's a possibility. That was the first time I realized I was like, I can be in danger in another country. Like, I really can be in danger. And that helped me because later on in an experience in Kazakhstan, they tried to make us go to Moscow in 2022. Brittany Griner's in prison and they're trying to make me go to Moscow. There's no embassy there. There's not like, And so yeah, I was like, I'm ready to leave. Like I had my passport in hand. I know this is about Hungary, but just to conclude the lesson, like make sure you're ready to leave at any moment, any moment. Make sure you have your people that you can rely on in the country to get you out at any moment, because they were really trying to push us. They're threatening us with playing time. You're not going to play in Champions League. Yeah, it was a whole thing. It was a whole thing. So this lesson prepared me for what happened in Kazakhstan.
Okay, so because my situation was different because I'm a dual citizen, I was born in the UK, and so for me, I think it was a little bit easier. And at the time, it was still EU, so I was okay to be there and okay to leave. But I didn't know. So you guys had to get visas to come play, is that correct? Okay. Wow. And so you're saying to advise future athletes, make sure you have the visa and you are in possession of it.
Possession, make sure it's in your passport. Yeah, because I think in Hungary they have the card.
Yeah.
And I had to take a like they took a picture of it for me. They had it at the office, at the club office, and then I was able to show it to authorities, and then they let me go. And I barely made my flight. And I just remember being drenched in sweat for the beginning of a 15-hour flight back to California, and then just so emotional. So yeah, make sure you're prepared.
So
I hope that doesn't happen to anyone, but I'm just saying, just be prepared to bounce, you
yeah.
know. Be prepared to leave.
Oh my God, he's horrible. And just kind of on a similar topic, with we spoke about it earlier, how he was withholding film from us. So I know this motherfucker, sorry, excuse my French, but he pissed me off. God, because I mentioned one of my reasons for staying was that I needed film to build my resume, to show it to new teams, right? So without film, it's like I was never there. It was like I was never there.
I've suffered all this for nothing.
Exactly. And so he always, like, the guy, got to give it to me. Freak, a smart genius. More names to be said, but very, he thought about what he was doing. And towards the end of the season, we were like, you know, where can we find our film? Where's the game from last week? We're trying to put together clips to move on to another team. And he kept sitting there being like, no, I'll give it to you later, or I'll give you the link later, or oh, I don't have it yet. And I'm thinking, what? This isn't right, because I know we were having highlights of our game. They were on YouTube. There is film. And so I remember, I don't know if you remember this, I contacted the people. Could you send me the link to this and this, or can I have access? Is there a username or something, a portal I can have access to? No dice. So I couldn't get it that way. And then I was like, all right, coach, so can we watch that game film from last week? We're trying to get better and, you know, try to twist it into a way that would benefit him. No, he kept kind of, I remember him sitting there like arms crossed thinking, you know, I give it to you later. I'll give it to you the end of the season. And I'm like, oh my God, this guy sucks. Moral of the story, he held it from us from a while. We never, ever got it. I actually did end up getting access to some of the games because an agent I hired in the future had access to a platform that showed all games. So I was like, the games exist. I did play soccer. This was real. But I don't even know how to advise in the future. There needs to be, like, if you're going to a team, this is important actually. Ask if they are going to record your games, ask if they're going to be live, and ask, yeah, how you're going to get access to them. Because in college, and especially in America, we're spoiled and we have these systems that our coaches or universities pay for. We have access to it. We are, you know, assigned to watch film and then review it. And so we have it. And it's just like, oh, that's just part of our normal day. Over here, no, it wasn't. So know if you're going to have access to that beforehand. Otherwise, it's kind of like you weren't there. Yeah, you're going to get the experience and you will be able to showcase yourself as a player whenever you go and show up to a trial in person. But other than that, if you're trying to build your resume or build a little highlight film, you need to know if you're going to have, you know, videos or not.
Yeah, and I would even add on to that, make sure because of that experience for the next one, I brought a whole external hard drive, like a little 2 terabyte. I was like, I don't care, I'm getting everything, I don't care.
Yeah. Do you actually?
It was great because I ended up getting everything. I collected everything onto one, and then because I think the coach was like, I don't want to do all of this. I was like, let me do it. Give me
Yeah.
all the games. I
Yeah.
got all the games, and then I distributed it to the rest of the girls. We ended up going to the store. We got a whole bunch of flash drives. I was like, bet, let me have all the flash drives. I was like, do. I know which games you played in, and it became. I'm telling you, I learned so much from this experience.
Yeah, and you just brought back a new memory, is that one of our teammates ended up recording the game on an iPad because he remember?
It was my roommate, the Canadian. She was like, yeah, I'm gonna
Yeah, so maybe like the last half of our games were filmed, but on an iPad. This is crazy. I forgot about
professional team. This is a professional women's soccer. And then
Yeah.
we have to record our games on an iPad.
Yeah, it'd be like that. We're really paving the way out there.
Really? Yeah, no, we crawled. We crawled. But yeah, kind of on the topic though of women's soccer in general, so I did have a romantic experience a little bit. I did meet somebody. It was the other black person on the other on the men's side. But it was great to be around him and compare and talk to him because we got to compare our experiences, right? He was on the second team. We're on the only team, which is the first team. And even he was amazed. He's like, what do you mean you don't have film? He was almost like looking at me like I was stupid. He was like, you have film. I was like, no, you don't understand. Like, we don't have the same. He tried to do it too, and he wasn't able to.
Wait, where is he from? I don't remember. Colombia? Ah,
Yeah,
rico.
so huge language barrier. I didn't speak Spanish. He didn't speak English. It was so much fun. It was so much fun. We just, but yeah. Anyways, and then we compared. Like he had his own flat.
Oh, must be
He was in
nice.
the city, and
Like the where I lived, right? Okay.
yeah. It was close. It was like, yeah. I don't remember how far away it was, but it was a nice area. And yeah, one bedroom, had a kitchen, had everything. He told me like how much he got paid, and obviously it was like a
How
ridiculous
many
amount
times,
compared to mine.
yeah, without disclosing, how many times?
Oh gosh. Oh my gosh. Let me think real quickly. These maybe I'm gonna say maybe 5 or 6 times as much as we did per month. We got paid quite a bit. Five or six times as many euros as we did. I don't even remember how much we got paid. Oh yeah, I had to remember. It was significantly more. It was like 7 or 8 times as much as we were making. And he had his own flat, and he was on the second team.
Wow.
Thank
Okay.
you. It was ridiculous. So he and so like I was, he was like he paid for when he learned how much I got paid.
He was like, "Never mind, stop paying. I'm gonna start giving you pocket money."
I told him. I said, listen, like I was 26 at the time, which meant I didn't have health insurance, right? And I'm not going to, and I would like to. I know we're running low on time, but I'd like to get into the healthcare part about your self-advocacy in healthcare when it comes to playing overseas. So I'm 26. I don't have health insurance, or I don't have my parents' health insurance anymore. I had to get a job overseas. So while I was studying, I was working too, through the university. I was doing research with Berkeley, like remotely. And so I was a paid researcher trying to pay for my health insurance. So pretty much all of that money went towards my health insurance and other little bits of my living. Because I had no choice. I did not trust what was going to be done overseas. And that was the right thing because we know with my Canadian the Canadian our Canadian teammate, she had trouble getting her ACL or ACL surgery paid for and covered by in a timely manner and by a responsible healthcare provider. And I watched her like optimistically, like, yeah, they're going to take care of me. I was like, I don't know. I don't know. So another word of advice. An actual doctor. Like, I was like, oh, finally, somebody who's going to listen to what I have to say. This dude wrote up the notes all in Hungarian. I told him I had a concussion. I told him all of my symptoms. I said, yeah, like, I'm really sensitive to light. I'm dizzy. All of them except for blacking out. And then he was like, yeah, definitely concussion. Yeah. You know, just make sure you're resting, blah, blah, blah. He gives me the papers all in Hungarian. And, you know, I didn't have Wi-Fi. I should have gotten, get the Wi-Fi, get that card. I should have done it because I Google translated when I got home and it says something entirely different.
You're kidding.
It said that I was fine. Mm-hmm. It said that I didn't have a concussion, just a mild headache. And that on paper gave our coach a reason to put me in the game that I wasn't supposed to be in. You remember that? I was not supposed to play in that game. I guess I could have been like, no, like, dude, I'm concussed. I can't be in the game. But yeah, you just, it's the trust thing. You got to be careful. Even the physicians there, if there's any sort of leverage for them, if there's any sort of gain for them to lie on documentation, they would do it. And it was a rough eye opener.
Yeah. Read the fine print. That's another thing. Whenever you're looking at your contract, look at what medical options they're offering. Look at your coverage. Look at your insurance. Look at what happens to you in the case that you get injured, which is foreshadowing for me, but I'm not going to say enough about that. But you did remind me, not me forgetting, that I went to a hospital in Hungary.
No, I thought about that.
So
she almost broke her leg in half.
Oh my God. And we can end on this final story, but then I do want to kind of ask what you're doing right now in California. But I want to know y'all's point of view, because in a game, I got tackled. Oh my God. I thought I broke my tibia. I was screaming bloody murder. It looked bad. The video looked bad. I never really get injured. And I was, could not. Oh my God. I was crying. I was not well. Got carried off on a stretcher. Probably not. Someone probably carried me with their hands. I went in an ambulance in, I can't remember what city we were in, wasn't the main one. And I straight up went in the back of an ambulance with Hungarian medical professionals, who spoke no English. So I'm with my phone, Google translating, which, where's my representative, right? What's going to happen to me if I'm injured? We need an English speaking person or someone to translate. I get to this hospital, lights are flickering. I'm going to just go ahead and paint the picture. It was like a horror film. There was blood on the floor, Sabs. Y'all didn't see what I had to see.
Play by play when we were in the bus, and I was like, oh my God, I'm taking video. I'm like, what do you
think this time? Yeah, I was like documenting this on my Snapchat. There was blood smudges on the floor. Lights were flickering. I was like, honestly, I think I don't need my leg. It's okay. They made me wait, like, obviously, I wasn't in dire need to see a doctor. Like, there were other people who needed medical attention before me. But I remember being put in a room with other patients. And that wasn't, I don't know. I just feel like that was, one, unhygienic, because people are like, there's open wounds in here. We were just separated by the little curtains. Like, I felt like I was in a horror film. I think I saw somebody who was dead. I'm not kidding. Like, being rolled past me. Yeah, it was scary. And another thing is they were asking me, like, I remember the doctor looked up once and like kind of looked at me, and the look said it all. He was like, she's just being a bitch. And I was like, it's broken, and take an x-ray. And we went to the x-ray. By the way, they never asked me if I was like wearing anything metal. Like, they asked me nothing about any history. And I was like, kind of scared. I was like, am I wearing jewelry, looking around? They put like this pad over me. Like, this is great. You know, this is just horrible. And at this point, I'm trying to relax. I get an x-ray. I'm fine. They're like, no, nothing's broken. I'm like, nothing's broken. Okay. Why can't I bear weight at all? I was in so much pain. And then remember someone like came from the bus to meet me at the hospital, and they piggybacked me into the car. That's how I got back to the van. I wish I had never gone. I guess an x-ray made me feel a little better, But now I just kind of looked like a little bitch because I was in so much pain and wasted all our time. The next...
I don't know the problem, though, but it, I really thought that it was. Like, and it was like a fat bruise, wasn't it?
Yes, and it was like yellow on my tibia. And I ended up getting a little... what is it called? An ultrasound, which is... I'm like, why are we ultrasounding my tibia? I don't really know much about that, but I kept feeling like I was being like shocked. They were doing some type of shock therapy or something, but that just wasn't it. And I saw our doctor back in town, and they just said it was a bone contusion. I'm like, okay, well, that I believe. At least it's not broken, and I couldn't play in our next game. Like, I even tried to put pressure. I could walk, I think, a few days after, but just horrible experience being over there in that medical system. It just wasn't fun.
No, it wasn't. It was, I mean, it really made me like appreciate, like, not the cost here, but at least some of the standard of care here. Because that in my other experiences was pretty much like,
yeah, how it was. Because at this point I'm like, I'll pay whatever to just be in a clean place, seen by somebody that I trust. And I know that I'm, you know, whatever they're going to tell me is accurate feedback. Oh, God.
Come to the U.S. And, you know, need access to mental health services. And we also do a lot of case management as well, like with immigration, housing, healthcare, childcare, all of those sort of things. So I'm on the data coordination and the Salesforce administration, and some little bit of tech, kind of public health, mental health in this case. But it's definitely a rewarding experience. Thankfully, I'm not equipped to be on the therapy end, but I'm glad I could do my part on like the data reporting and organization end to get more money, like for grants, to keep this organization running. But I do have plans really soon to be taking the CIC, which is the certification to be an infection preventionist. And once that's done, I would be eligible to apply for infection prevention positions at healthcare facilities. So they're the ones who like write policies and make sure guidelines are being followed to make sure there's no like outbreaks or anything of that sort. But they also do outbreak investigations. So they're disease detectives, which would be what my degree is meant for. So I'm heading there, but right now I really like the work that I'm doing at the moment.
Sabs, that's incredible. You just said all these things that are foreign to me, but that's so incredible. And do you think that, I mean, your experiences playing soccer, especially abroad and in Europe, kind of helped you get where you are today?
100%. If you say that in an interview, they love that. People think it's cool, but also it does prepare you well for a workplace, for, you know, like, we're hardworking people. Athletes are just hardworking. We are resilient. We also know what it feels like to go head to head with with teammates, with people in authority. Like, we know what that feels like. And we're also great teammates. We want to make sure that the mission gets done. So when I'm put in a place where, you know, non-soccer related, where I can do that, then I thrive. And I know other athletes do too. So yeah, I think athletes in the workplace, especially depending on the field, is extremely advantageous. And if there's anyone hesitant to think that saying you played soccer at the college level or any level isn't helpful in an interview or for somebody to get to know you, it is. It absolutely is. Even if your job has nothing to do with soccer, do it, because that was my hesitancy. So people like to hear what your passion is and you know, what you did in your life.
Love that, because there is a little bit of an advantage having those transferable skills from the team setting, from being in a different culture and environment, and then moving that into the work field. I mentioned that before in a previous episode, but yeah, very cool. And then my last question for you to the audience is, or not question, just kind of, do you have a little piece of advice to tell Sabs from from 3 years ago? What would you tell an athlete who may or may not be getting into the same situation that you were in before they go? What piece of advice would you leave them with if they are heading on their new endeavor to a team in Europe?
That's a great question. I would say be prepared for a roller coaster, but enjoy the ride, and be authentic. Be even if nobody likes you, even if you say things that, you know, people look at you funny because you're an American, because you're loud, because whatever it is, do not hide yourself. Make sure, yeah, you're being yourself, even if you coming through with injuries, you're coming through with doubts, be honest about it.
Yeah.
You know, be authentic, because hiding away is gonna take away from the experience. And I don't regret going to Hungary. So I learned a lot about myself there. So that would be my advice. Prepare for that roller coaster.
I love that. And you hit one of my core values, which is authenticity. Cause I've been in a couple of different countries. I'm just fully embracing being American. I'm also a dual citizen, but I'm not really that British. I don't come off British, you know, but I come off very American, and I just hone it and use it to your advantage and use it to share your experiences and hopefully enhance other people's as well. But really great advice. And thank you so, so much for taking the time to chat with us today. I miss you. I'm like, when am I going to see you in person? I don't have to make a California trip, or let me know.
I have family in Texas. I need, it's me. It's, I'm the problem. I'll come and see you, girl.
Wait, like March time? Because I talked to Claire and we have a rodeo going on.
I've never been to a rodeo. You guys need to put me on.
I will. Yeah. Okay. I'll reach back out to you obviously after this, but yes, if I could get you for the rodeo, that would be incredible.
No. Let's try to make this happen.
Yay. Okay. Let's do it. But thank you again, seriously, for sharing that. I know that was kind of probably a little difficult to unpack those memories from a while ago. And I am sorry that you had to experience the things that you did. Just so all athletes know, it's not, our experiences were not meant to be like that. Unfortunately, they are normal in the sense of they do happen way too often. But the goal of this podcast especially is to prevent this from happening and to just further inform other athletes what you could be getting into and then how to better prepare. So thank you so much again, Sabs, and best of luck with your potentially new position, and good luck with your certificate and your, yeah.
Thank you. I appreciate it.